Hare Krishna. On the sacred occasion of the appearance day of Lord Balaram, let's look at two special prayers that are offered to Balaramji in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, the Srimad Bhagavatam focuses its 10th canto primarily on Krishna as the central character and as also the object of worship. So in not many places are prayers offered to Balaramji separately. In fact, Balaramji doesn't appear in any independent role much in the Bhagavatam. He does kill some demons like Dhenukasur and Pralambasur. He does fight with some of the wrestlers in the wrestling arena, and often he's by the side of Krishna. Whatever he's doing, he goes to the times. But generally, prayers are offered to Krishna. For example, Indra, Brahma, and Govardhan Lila, Brahma, Lila, they offer prayers to Krishna. Now, when Krishna and Balaram are going from Vrindavan to Mathura, at that time, Balaramji is also the object of prayers by Akrura along with Krishna. So both of them are offered prayers. Again, the primary focus is Krishna, but there Krishna and Balaram reveal themselves as Vishnu and Shesha. So prayers are offered to both. But prayers to Balaramji specifically alone, now where can they occur? When Balaramji is separated from Krishna. Or Balaramji is doing some activity in which Krishna is not present, and he does something heroic. So that we see in the Bhagavatam. Now there are many occasions where this happens, and there are various places where Balabhadra Sahasranam or Balabhadra Rajastava, there are many prayers to Balaramji that are offered, but in the Bhagavatam these prayers are not mentioned. These occur in other Puranas like the Garga Samhita and Brahma Vivarta Purana, like that. In the Bhagavatam, only one place this happens. In the 65th chapter of the 10th canto, where Balaramji comes to Vrindavan, Krishna sends him, and when he is there, he pacifies the Vrajavasis and especially the gopis, and he performs Rasdila with his own set of gopis. And at that time, when he wants to bathe in the Jamuna, he summons Jamuna, but Balaramji appears to be intoxicated at that time because Varuni has come there in the form of delicious intoxicating sort of beverage which oozes out through the tree as sap, and Balaramji has drunk that, and his motions appear to be like that of a drunkard. And Yamuna feels a little shocked, appalled, dismayed by this kind of appearance of Balaramji, and she refuses to obey. And when she refuses to obey, then Balaramji just takes his plow and drags her along. Yes, he says, "You will not come to me, I will drag you and bring you here." So when he exhibits this prowess, then Yamuna understands that actually this is my worshipable Lord himself. No matter how he looks, even if he looks drunk, he's still the Supreme Lord. This is just his appearance of being drunk is simply a leela. And she offers prayers. Now it may seem that why does Lord Balaramji first why does he get drunk? Then why does he, while being drunk, command Jamuna in such a way that she is likely to misunderstand? And then when she refuses, is he like so such a short-tempered person that he has to sort of rip Jamuna and drag her along? No, we have to understand that the Lord demonstrates certain principles through his actions. So here he is demonstrating that we shouldn't let our perception, our sensual perception, sensory perception, blind us to the scriptural reality. So scripture declares that Balaramji is as good as Krishna in most ways. He is the Supreme Lord himself. and no matter how he behaves, he still remains the Supreme Lord. So if we let Pratyaksha override Shabda, then that is the formula for illusion. That illusion can be in the form that we may see the things of this world as objects of pleasure, when scripture tells us that they are actually sources of misery. Dukkayonayayavate, Bhagavata 5.22 tells us. And that misunderstanding can happen if we give precedence to Pratyaksha or Shabda, also with the Supreme Lord. You know, we may see him and we misunderstand him. Duryodhana saw Krishna and even saw the Virat Rupa of Krishna, Vishwarupa of Krishna, and still what did he think? This is Krishna showing some magic. He didn't accept Krishna as God, he didn't surrender to God. So we shouldn't let Pratyaksha Praman override Shabda Praman. And so in these prayers which Jamuna offers, her theme is that, oh, please forgive me that I had not realized your glories. I did not know your glories. No means she is not ignorant, but at that particular time she was not knowing. So please, now I know your glories, now I surrender to you. Please forgive me, please release me. So it often happens in our life also that we may misunderstand the Lord's prowess, minimize his prowess or position because of giving excessive importance to our own perceptions. So this is a very good prayer to meditate on and offer to the Lord whenever we blunder like that, or also as a prayer, precautionary prayer, to pray to him that we to preempt against such blunders, to avoid such blunders. So let's look at these two prayers. So the first is 10.65.28. राम राम महाबाहो न जाने तव विक्रमं यस्य कामशेन विद्रुता जगति जगत पते. So here Jamuna is praying, राम राम महाबाहो, ओ राम, ओ बलराम जी. So we know one of the names of among the many names of this divine supreme personality, the name Ram conveys the idea of him being the reservoir of pleasure. The Padma Puran says, Ramante yogino nante satyananda chidatmani tirama padenasau param brahma vidhiyate. So because the yogis can get unlimited pleasure from Lord Ram, so therefore he is called as, they can get unlimited pleasure from the absolute truth, so he is called as Ram. So now here she is also using the word Ram. Now in the Vaishnava Toshani Tika, it's explained that why does she use the word Ram? Because she is implying, my dear Lord, you give pleasure to everyone. So please don't afflict me, please don't punish me, please don't cause me misery. And because she is so ashamed of her actions, that in her frantic anxiety to mitigate her disrespect of the Lord, and in the hope of attracting the attention of the Lord. And if somebody is angry, that person is so caught up in the anger, the person may not even perceive what we are saying. So in order to attract his attention, she says, Rama, Rama. She repeats the word Rama, Rama twice. And then, to further draw his attention, to the point that she has now understood his power, she refers to him also by the name Mahabaho. Yeah, I had not understood you, but now you are extremely powerful. I acknowledge it. You are Baho. Your arm is so powerful. Who else could have done this feat of lift, of dragging me like this? You are Mahabaho. You are immensely powerful. And then now, why are you saying like this? Why did you not obey my command earlier? Na jane tava vikramam. I did not know your power. So because of now we understand that everything that happens in Vrindavan is ultimately orchestrated by Yoga Maya, and Yamuna Devi actually never falls under Mahamaya like we may fall. This whole pastime is orchestrated by the Yoga Maya, but we can also learn that we should not fall in Mahamaya. So she is saying that I had become covered by illusion, najane tava vikramam. I didn't know your prowess, and that's why I disobeyed you. And now what is the prowess that you are so celebrated for? How do I really understand your position? How do I know that? How can Balaram say, how do I know that you have understood the position? She's telling, Yesse kam shena vidruta jagati, that jagati, this world, this jagati can refer to this universe, or can more specifically refer to the earth. So he says this whole material existence is just sustained by ek amshena, by just one fragment of you. So he's saying that actually it is not even your limb. It is not that you have to raise your hand and lift up and hold it. No, it's just one expansion of you that is doing the work. Isse kam shena vidruta. Now this use of the means the use of amsha, use of demonstrating one's power by demonstrating the power of one's amsha is done even in the Bhagavad Gita. In 10.42 it is said, Athava bahunaitena kim jnatena tava arjuna vishthabhyahamidam krishnam ekamshena stito jagat. So same word, here also it's esse kamshena, there also it is ekamshena. So Krishna is given the Virat the Vibhuti's description in the 10th chapter, and he concludes by saying that, oh Arjuna, what is the need for this elaborate description of my opulences? Kim jnatena, what is the need to know? I'll just summarize it. Vishthabhyahamidam kritsnam. This whole kritsnam is completely, thoroughly. Ekam shena stito jagat stito. That I have pervaded and sustained this whole universe just by one fragment of me. This of course I can refer to Anantashish. That he is sustaining the universe is on his hood. So Vidruta Jagati Jagatapate Jagatapate, you are the lord of this universe. Now you have sustained the whole universe, and within that universe are many many planets. And within those planets the earth is one planet, and on that planet there are many rivers, and among them I am one river, and I am sustained by you. So where is your position and where is my position? How can I understand your glories, my dear Lord? I simply know that you are immensely powerful, and I accept your prowess. So in the first prayer, she simply acknowledges in the Lord's glories and glorifies him wholeheartedly. So she admits her ignorance, najane tava vikramam, and she uses four glorifications for the Lord. Ram, Ram, which comes twice. You are the reservoir of pleasure, so please don't afflict me. You give pleasure to the world, please don't afflict me. Mahabaho, and oh, you are immensely powerful. I acknowledge your prowess, something which I had not done earlier. And the demonstration of your prowess is that Isse kam shena vidruta jagati. You, by one fragment, one expansion of you, one part of you sustain the whole world. And then jagata pate. You are the master of the universe and I am a small part of this universe. I cannot understand you, but because you are the master of the whole universe, please protect me also. That is implicit. So in the first verse, she primarily glorifies the Lord. And in the next verse, she will ask for protection. This 29th verse. Param bhavam bhagavato bhagavan mama jam Param bhavam bhagavato Bhagavan mama janatim muktum arhasi vishwatman prapannam bhaktavatsala. So she says, Param bhavam, your supreme nature, your supremacy, your transcendental position, Param bhavam bhagavato, bhagavato, connected with Bhagavan, Bhagavan. So you are transcendental. That Bhagavan mama janatim, I did not know about it, but now I have come to know about it. Moktum arhasi vishwatman. So again she says, you are the soul of the universe. You are inside everything, you sustain everything. Moktum arhasi, it befits that you liberate me, you release me. Why? You disobeyed me, you deserve to be punished. Why should you be liberated? He says that actually, prapannam bhakta vatsala prapannam, I surrender to you. And if somebody surrenders to you, you, O Lord, are a bhaktavatsala. You are the lover of your devotees. You are the caretaker of your devotees. So here she is praying that, oh my dear Lord, I did not know your glory and that's why I did wrong. But now that I have come to know of your glory, I have surrendered to you. And you are the protector of the surrendered. So please protect me. Please release me. Moktum arhasi. So she is now. So the point is that sometimes we may go into illusion and that is unfortunate. That is of course preventable. But sometimes it is by the force of circumstances, by lack of caution or whatever, we may go into illusion. So what is more important is not that we never go into illusion. We can try our best to never go into illusion, but we may go into illusion. That is the first mistake. But what is important is how we respond to that mistake. Do we correct that mistake or do we perpetuate that mistake? So perpetuating that mistake means that we try to justify what I did and we try to prove that what I did was right. No, we admit that we are wrong and then we correct it. Sometimes trying to justify one's mistake can get one into far greater trouble. Suppose I slip out on a dark night in a forested road without a torch and then suddenly I put my leg on a snake and a snake comes and bites me and I'm in intense pain. So now I made a mistake by going carelessly in that area. Now when I see the snake slithering away after biting me, if I make a mistake secondly and become angry, and you snake, you bit me, you hurt me, now I will hurt you. And we chase after the snake to kill the snake. Now that would be a double mistake. So that second mistake will actually aggravate the first mistake, and where the poison would not have spread so fast and we might have been able to save ourselves. If we chase after the snake, in running after it, the poison will spread faster and we may well die also. So like that, the first mistake may not be avoidable. But the second mistake is, that means once we become aware, okay, I have done something wrong, now let me correct myself as quickly as possible. So Jamuna demonstrated that actually now that I was earlier parambhavam ajanatim, I did not know your parambhava. But once I came to know, then what have I done? Then prapannam, I have surrendered to you. And therefore, my dear Lord, please release me. Muktum arhasi. So when we fall under illusion in whatever way it is, we can also pray when we chant, when we go before the deities, my dear Lord, please release me from this illusion. Now Krishna, ultimately Yoga Maya which catches also, acts by Krishna's will only. Chaye vyasya bhuvanani bibharti durga icchanurupam api asya cha cheshtate sa. So Durga actually acts as a chaya. Chaye vyasya bhuvanani bibharti durga. So she acts as a chaya and she acts according to his will. So whenever we go into illusion also, it is because we have shown interest in illusion, we have courted danger, and then Krishna has, in order to teach us a lesson, allowed us to fall into illusion. So if we pray to Krishna, Krishna, now I understood how powerful you are. I need your protection to save myself, and how powerful your illusory energy is. That if I don't stand your protection, I will fall under your illusory energy. Now I understood your glory, I want to surrender to you. Please release me from illusion. Moktum arhasi vishwatman prapannam bhaktavatsalaha moktum arhasi. Please release me. And you are the protector of the surrendered. I surrender to you, my Lord. Please release me. So in this way we can pray to Balaramji that, my dear Lord, please release me from illusion. You are the source of Bala. Please give me Bala by which when temptation comes, I can resist temptation. I can stay fixed in devotion. Shri Balaram Ji ki jai. Shri Balaram Avibhav Tithi Mahotsav ki jai. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.